Merry Christmas, everybody. Yeah, I know I'm a little bit too late to the party on this one, but hey, better late than never, I always say. So let's celebrate this belated holiday that I pushed off because Christmas has gotten too busy in my personal life and talk about something besides commercials like I always do every single year. So what am I going to be reviewing this time? I'm going to be reviewing an unconventional Christmas movie. Now, what is an unconventional Christmas movie, you may ask? Well, for those few people who don't know what it is, an unconventional Christmas movie is a movie that's not normally associated with the holiday season, but it takes place around Christmas, so it technically counts. Yeah, you know the ones I'm talking about. I'm talking about movies like Die Hard, Gremlins, Batman Returns, Lethal Weapon, and many others. But instead of reviewing a movie that is awesome like those movies, we're gonna be taking a look at a cheesy, obscure movie that I'm pretty sure none of you have ever heard of. So, what do you get when you have Cronenberg's The Fly turn into a lizard? Well, you get the origin story to a one Dr. Kurt Connors, aka the lizard. Ah, yes, the lizard. One of Spider-Man's greatest enemy and value member of the Sinister Six. Making his first debut in...
Yeah, that's nice, Dr. Know-It-All, but I'm not referring to one of Spider-Man's greatest villains.
Oh! Ooh. Sorry about that. I guess you don't need me then.
Nope, we're not. Anyway, this is Metamorphosis.
Now, from that description alone, you might be wondering, well, what does any of this have to do with Christmas? Well, let's see. The movie takes place around Christmas, there's Christmas decorations in the background, and even the characters say,
Merry Christmas.
So yeah, it technically counts as a Christmas movie. But is it a good Christmas movie? Well, that's where we're here to find out today. So without further delay, this is Metamorphosis.
Alright, so the movie starts off with some lost footage from Teen Wolf as we're introduced to the main character of the movie, Dr. Peter Houseman, played by Gene LeBrock. He's a geneticist who, despite not having luck perfecting the first ever successful anti-aging serum, has no problem at all with attracting every woman within the college campus. Seriously, this guy is the ultimate sex magnet when it comes to the ladies. Even some of his students are having the hots for him.
Though I can't blame him that much. I mean, he does look like a mixture between Christopher Reeves and Tom Cruise.
Anyway, his class gets interrupted by one of the employees who hands him a letter from the school's chancellor. But instead of being selected to be the next fighter in the Super Smash Bros. Game, God, I only wish, he's been informed that his funding for his next project has been cut off by the school board. This gets him so upset that he marches into the office and settles the score once and for all.
Dr. Houseman, please, a moment, you can't go in there.
Oh, screw you, lady. If I had my lecture being interrupted by someone who sent me a letter instead of talk to me on a face-to-face basis, then yeah, I will definitely interrupt him as much as I please. It's all fair game from here.
So the chancellor reveals that it's out of his control, and it was all the board's decision to put his experiment through investigation since he never documented his research to begin with. Let's just say that he's none too pleased by this, almost to the point of roasting every member of the board.
Each of us has to publish his work, myself included. I don't see why you should be the exception.
Because I don't write jokes, and I wouldn't get the same laughs as you.
He experiments on a baboon since he needs something to show the board members that he's using the money wisely, and well, let's just say that the experiment didn't go according to plan.
The good news is that the monkey didn't die in the most inhumane and grotesque way, like in The Fly. Yeah, good luck keeping your lunch down after seeing that scene. So because the board is suspicious about his experiment, they decide to suspend all funding for his research until the investigation is over. But Peter isn't having any of this as he continues to do the experiment on himself.
You know, for a bunch of scientific researchers, you don't really know the scientific process all that well, do you?
What, was the monkey death scene from earlier not enough to convince you this was a bad idea? At least the smartest thing you could have done is experiment on another animal before hastily going for the whole procedure. Heck, even this rabbit has test subject written all over him.
Yeah. What's up, Doc?
Houseman. So after completing the experiment, he rushes over to the investigator's house and tells her about his latest discovery. Apparently, he's still alive and didn't die off screen like the monkey from earlier, so that means his experiment was automatically a success! Despite him not documenting any evidence, which was the thing that pulled his funding to begin with, all the while having no proof that he did the experiment on himself. But hey, you just gotta take his word for it, because... reasons.
Wait. Do you want to come in for a minute?
Sure, it's not too late.
She invites him in for a cup of coffee as it's revealed that she has a son. And like many child actors during this time period, his acting is, well...
Hi, I wasn't sleeping. I was waiting for you.
Pretty mediocre at best. But hey, at least his taste in movies isn't as bland as his acting abilities, so that counts for something, right?
Speaking of which, why am I not reviewing that movie instead? Oh wait, never mind. It takes place around Halloween instead of Christmas. My bad.
So everything seems to be going well for Peter so far. He hasn't died from the experiment, he now has superhuman strength, and he now gains the affection of the woman who's investigating his research. However, that all seems to change as Peter discovered that someone had spilt Strawberry Fanta all over his nice handkerchief, only to remember bits and pieces of what happened the night before. And this is the part of the movie where I had issues comprehending the second act. It took me a while to fully understand where the filmmakers were going with this, but most of the time, it's just head-scratching and it completely makes you wonder what's going on from here on out. I mean, one minute we're seeing Peter having a nice evening at the zoo, only to come back to this random topless woman getting her head smashed in. And this isn't the only time these flashbacks appear. No. These flashbacks appear in the most random of places. I get that they were trying to set up some sort of mystery or suspense, but the way they did it was just poorly executed. So yeah, in case you were confused the first time watching it as I was, then let me try to explain this to the best of my abilities. Peter starts to have amnesia about what happened during that one fateful night, which pays him a visit to the bar from his flashbacks to seek some answers. And let's just say the employees are none too pleased by him.
Not on the face! Get him over here!
So Peter goes full Hulk mode on the whole staff while punching this guy so hard in the face that he starts to bleed barbecue sauce. He becomes so frightened of what he has become that he decides to do what every teenage girl does whenever she's too scared to end a relationship that isn't working out, ghost everybody until help is needed the most. He touches bases with one of his co-workers to help him cure him of this condition, but it seems to get gradually worse as he goes on another murderous rampage. This time the victim in question is the college student from earlier who has the hots for him. And just like the subplot involving the prostitute at the bar, this scene is very confusing the first time watching it, mainly because we don't get any context showing us where we're at or what's going on. Now, of course, we did get some foreshadowing in an earlier scene.
What's this?
It's my address. I'm having a party at my house. I'd like it if you could come.
When?
Any day. Anytime you like.
But it would have been nice to show us what happened beforehand instead of showing us this college girl going all Michael Myers on him. It just makes it all the more discombobulated.
Ah!
So the police finally catches Peter in the act, as he is sent to the hospital so he can be treated of his condition. Apparently, the serum is making his condition so worse that he's beginning to turn into Ebenezer Scrooge. So as Sally assures him that the doctors will eventually find a cure for him, he tells her that there is no hope for him and that it's best to find someone else. But apparently, she isn't able to take a hint. Strawberry jam all over my mouth. It was so disgusting. So as the doctors are still investigating his illness, one of the members of the board receives a floppy disk that contains all the research that Peter has been gathering. And what new discoveries does this floppy disk hold?
It's not just a mutation, it's a regression. I've been studying his notes. Dr. Hausman injected himself with cells with modified DNA, the genetic information that he believed controlled cellular aging. But he opened up a dormant information, one that hasn't been active for millions of years. That information is transforming him into what we were. Maybe even before the advent of the mammals, the remote time of our evolution.
My God.
My God, indeed. After all this time, who would have guessed that his research has been leading up to predicting the Super Mario Brothers movie? Or it might have just been a coincidence. So with this new discovery in hand, he pays a visit to Peter while gloating about how he'll be taking all the credit for his research once Peter has slowly passed away.
I want to dissect you to find out what the devil you've become.
I can satisfy your curiosity right now.
Oh. No!
I am becoming to the Tadpolosaurus!
Metamorphosis will continue as long as I have what I need. Nutriment. Now, I have it in abundance.
So Peter escapes the hospital to find the serum that was given to Sally as he comes across a mall Santa giving out gifts. Admittedly, this is the funniest part in the movie. Run for your lives! Jackie Earl Haley's Freddy Krueger is back to make another Nightmare on Elm Street sequel! Once Peter makes it back to Sally's house, he demands for her to give him the serum since it's better in his hands than in the hands of the government.
Give me the serum.
Now give me the bottle in my strong hand.
So Sally hides in the bathroom to get away from Peter's wrath, but it turns out that the babysitter is not so lucky. Okay, I know I shouldn't be laughing at this scene, but come on! The mother's reaction to all this is just priceless. Seriously, this is where the mother's acting went from somewhat passable to downright laughably bad, especially when she's more concerned about where her son is rather than her friend's well-being. And it's not like she even asked if she was alright or if she needs an ambulance to come pick her up or anything like that. She just abandons the poor woman to go after her son. Yeah, some friend you turned out to be. So as Sally heads over to the lab, her son tries to escape but gets caught by Peter. He hides away from him, but ends up grabbing the bottle of serum out of self-defense. No! Not my limited edition Pepsi Blue! That would have gone for millions on eBay! So Sally escapes the lab with her son, but the police are already there on Peter's trail to hunt him down. And this is where we see the most goofiest monster costume in all of horror movie history. You ready? Are you sure? You might want to sit down for this one. Okay, fine. Show the clip. I'm sorry, but come on. How can you take any of this seriously? This costume is so beyond goofy and ridiculous that it's way too easy to come up with jokes for this scene alone. In fact, I don't think I can make a joke that will make this scene even funnier. Well, except for this one.
Shoot her!
So as Peter turns into Godzilla's miscarriage, Sally's son wanders around the lab and comes across a lizard that he decides to keep as a pet. The next day rolls by and Sally decides that she needs a vacation just to get away from it all. But little does she know that Peter has been her son's pet lizard all this time.
Breaking news, the film has officially jumped the shark with this ludicrous ending. Oh, who am I kidding? This movie is schlock. But enjoyable schlock at that.
Seriously, this is one of those movies that is so bad that it deserves to be featured on an episode of Mystery Science Theater 3000. And coincidentally enough, this movie did have a Blu-ray release made by Shout Factory's horror division, Scream Factory. So for them not to riff on a cheesy horror movie that Shout Factory owns the rights to is far from inexcusable, especially when they raised enough money to continue producing more Mystery Science Theater episodes. If you're looking for a cheesy Christmas-themed movie that features a monster that looks like Barney on crystal meth, then this movie will be right up your alley. Give it a watch and have yourself a good laugh this holiday season.
And that's pretty much all I have to say. Anyway, guys, I hope you have a wonderful new year, and I will see you next time. Take care.